Here's another EM quiz. For this quiz, we'll assume a degenerative case of V data points and just one cluster center. My question pertains to the shape of the Gaussian after fitting, specifically mu and sigma. And the question is sigma circular, it would be like this, or elongated, be like this, or like this? And the answer is, of course, elongated. As you look over here, what you find is that this is the best Gaussian describing the data points, and this is what EM will calculate. This is a quiz in which I compare EM versus k-means. Suppose we're given four data points as indicated by those circles. Suppose we have two initial cluster centers shown here in red, and those converge to possible places that are indicated by those four squares. Of course, they won't take all four of them, they just take two of them. But for now, I'm going to give you four choices. Let me call this cluster 1, cluster 2, A, B, C, and D. In EM, will C1 move towards A, or will C1 move towards B? And in contrast, in K-means, will C1 move towards A, or will C1 move towards B? This is just asking about the left side of the diagram. So the question is, will K-means find itself in the more extreme situation, or will EM find itself in the more extreme situation? And the answer is that while K-means will go all the way to the extreme A, which is this one over here, EM will not. And this has to do with the soft versus hard nature of the correspondence. In K-means, the correspondence is hard. So after the first iteration, only these two data points over here correspond to cluster center 1, and it'll find itself straight in the middle where A is located. In EM, however, we find that there'll still be a soft correspondence to these further away points, which will then lead to a small shift of the cluster center to the right side as indicated by B. That means K-means and EM will converge the different models of the data. One of the remaining open questions pertains to the number of clusters. So far, I've assumed it's simply constant, and you know it. But in reality, you don't know it. Practical implementations often guess the number of clusters along with the parameters. And the way this works is that you periodically evaluate which data is poorly covered by the existing mixture. You generate new cluster centers at random near unexplained points. And then you run the algorithm for a while to see whether the existence of your clusters is still justified. And the justification test is based on a minimization of a criterion that combines the negative log likelihood of your data itself and a penalty for each cluster. In particular, you're going to minimize the negative log likelihood of your data given the model plus a constant penalty per cluster. If you look at this expression, this is the expression that EM already minimizes. We maximize the posterior probability of data. Logarithmic is a monotonic function, and I put a minus sign over here, so the optimization problem becomes a minimization problem. This one over here, where you have a constant cost per cluster, is new. If you increase the number of clusters, you pay a penalty that is in the way of your attempted minimization. Typically, this expression balances out at a certain number of clusters that is generically the best explanation for your data. So the algorithm works as follows. Guess an initial k, run EM, remove unnecessary clusters that will make the score over here go up, create some new random clusters, and go back and run EM. There's all kinds of variants of this algorithm. One of the nice things here is this algorithm also overcomes local minima problems to some extent. If, for example, two clusters end up grabbing the same data, then your test should show you that one of the clusters can be omitted, but the score can be improved. That cluster can later be restarted somewhere else, and by randomly restarting clusters, you tend to get much, much better solution than if you run EM just once with a fixed number of clusters. So this trick is highly recommended for any implementation of exploitation maximization. This finishes my unit on clustering, at least so far. I just want to briefly summarize what we've learned. We talked about k-means, and we talked about exploitation maximization. K-means is a very simple binary, almost binary algorithm. It allows you to find cluster centers. EM is a probabilistic generalization. It also allows you to find clusters, but also modifies the shapes of the clusters and modifying the covariance matrix. EM is probabilistically sound, and we can prove convergence in a log likelihood space. K-means also converges. Both are prone to local minima. In both cases, you need to know the number of cluster centers K. I showed you a brief trick how to estimate K as you go, which also overcomes local minima to some extent. Let's now talk about a second class of unsupervised learning algorithms. They're called dimensionality reduction. And I'm going to start with a little quiz in which I will check your intuition. Suppose we're giving a two-dimensional data field, and our data lines up as follows. My quiz is, how many dimensions do we really need? And the key is the word really, which means we're willing to tolerate a certain amount of error and inaccuracy because you want to capture the essence of the problem. And the answer is obviously one. This is the key dimension over here. The orthogonal dimension in this direction carries almost no information. So it suffices in most cases to project the data onto this one-dimensional space. Here's a quiz that is a little bit more tricky. I'm going to draw data for you like this. I'm going to ask the same question. How many dimensions do we really need? And this answer is not at all trivial. And I don't blame you if you got it wrong. The answer is actually one. But the projection itself is non-linear. I can draw really easily a nice one-dimensional space that follows these data points. And if I'm able to project all the data points on this one-dimensional space, I capture the essence of the data. The trick, of course, is to find the non-linear one-dimensional space and to describe it. This is what's going on in the state of the art in dimensionality reduction research.